schon militant, das ist mein Schild. Wenn er dies war, wenn er die kam. Namam Vishnu Brahma Shabasa Uttani Shimate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namanim. Namaste Sasvani Devi Govani Pachayane Nivashisha Shunyavani Pashadarishatarinam. Vanchakalpa Tuvasa Paditanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Bhavanityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasari Govardhana Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Ramo 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 Hare Hare. Okay, so welcome everybody to day number two of our seminar on Children Are Our Future. So today's topic will be that we want to try and get some insights into this whole process of Gavadha and Samskara. So yesterday in the last section, yeah, let me just see, are you getting some translation, Prabhu? Here, yes. Okay. And yes, please have the German materials in front of you because we will read quite a few sections from the Bhagavatam. So it just makes it so much easier. Then the translator doesn't even have to translate and you can just read it along in German, you know? Yes, so yesterday, towards the end of the evening session, we were introducing the topic of samskaras in general, and we were reading these nice little descriptions that, first of all, samskaras have the potential to remove blemishes and generate divine qualities in the child, even when it is still in the womb. And yeah, that was the main, and that it's not just formalities or social function or something, but there are some subtle effects. It is a way for the parents to already communicate with the child and help the child grow spiritually and physically. And yeah, so it's quite a powerful science, actually, which is not so known in the Western world because, well, we have not really educated our devotees, you know? And that's why these things are not so widely understood. So, yes, let us now begin with lesson two. And to begin with, we can remember that we do have nice examples in the Bhagavatam, which clearly illustrate that it is not by chance which soul takes birth in which family. It's not by chance. It's a whole science. How to actually attract an elevated soul to take birth in our family. So, example is Prishni and Sutapa, or Kadama Muni and Devahuti. So they prepared themselves to receive an elevated personality. And Krishna himself took birth in their families. Wow, amazing, you know? So, and then we have the example of Kasyapa Muni and Diti, who conceived at the wrong time and with the wrong attitude. And well, we know the outcome, what happened there. Two demons took birth. So, you know, these examples very clearly illustrate that it is not by chance what soul we attract, you know? So we can basically say, following the regulative principles of sex life, we attract a saintly child. unregulated sex life, we attract children with demoniac qualities. Well, it may sound a little heavy, you know. How can a child with demoniac qualities take birth in a Vaishnava family? But even there, we also have examples in the Shastra. And demoniac qualities are already, you know, tendencies of wanting to enjoy sense gratification, being very attached to enjoying sense gratification, being in forgetfulness of Krishna. These are, whether we like it or not, there are demoniac qualities, you know. So, and these things also happen in Vaishnava families, you know. I mean, I know quite a few devotees, even senior devotees, where the children are rascals, you know, and they take drugs and do all kinds of nonsense. And you wonder, how is this happening? And even if the parents try their best, you know, to bring up the child in Krishna consciousness, but yeah, if we already invited a soul which doesn't really have that tendency and inclination, then we may just not get the desired result, you know. So, yeah, good to understand, you know, especially, I mean, I have to admit or express, I do really feel inspired to give this course here because we have so many young couples now forming, and I really hope to, you know, give you something here to have a good start, you know, and especially also in a rural community like Simhachalam. It's really the opportunity to create a model in the Western world, you know, where we implement all these cultural aspects. I find this really exciting, you know, because rural community, we are already away from all this nonsense which happens in the cities, and you know, it's the perfect grounds to really try and implement all these things and actually bring about an empowered generation of devotees. You know, this is really inspiring to me, you know. Yes. So let us read a little bit just to get some clue. Prabhu, you want the welcome. Thank you for coming. Huh? Yes. But do we have some materials for Munindra Prabhu? What do you prefer, German or English? German? Is there German materials though? Huh? Just give him for now English and you can later copy him a German one. Hmm? Okay, so fourth canto, 14th chapter, verse 42. I mean, these are all things in the Bhagavatam, you know. Prabhupada puts everything in the Bhagavatam because the Bhagavatam is the law books for the next 10,000 years for civilized, cultured human life. So here we hear. The pious seminal succession in the twice-born families of the Brahmanas and Kshatras especially, as well as in the families of Vaishyas also, must be kept very pure by the observation of the purificatory processes, beginning with Garbhadhan Samskara, which is observed before conceiving a child. Unless this purificatory process is strictly observed, especially by the Brahmanas, the family descendants become impure, and gradually sinful activities become visible in the family. Maharaj Anga was very pure because of the purification of semen in the family of Maharaj Dhruva. However, his semen became contaminated in association with his wife, Sunita, who happened to be the daughter of death personified. Because of this polluted semen, King Vena was produced. You know, so very nicely, Prabhupada explains how it works. Factually, it does, whether we believe it or not. This is the laws of nature. You know? So very nicely, Prabhupada describes how the semen has to be kept pure. And if this doesn't take place, then demoniac influences and qualities appear in the family. And then we have, yeah, not such saintly persons. So and this is why, you know, in Kali Yuga, nobody follows this. The science is all lost and forgotten, unknown. And that's why, you know, the modern population is Sudra, because as we mentioned yesterday, they were the only ones who were not following this process of Garbhadhara and Samskara. You know? So, and that's why the general population in these modern days are Sudras and with demoniac qualities. So, I mean, Prabhupada explains all these things because he expects, this was his vision, that, you know, ISKCON should really create saintly leaders for humanity, you know? So Prabhupada was thinking big time, you know? He really wanted to revolutionize, you know, the human society in this world. He was not just thinking small time of just, you know, having some little temples there where we chant Hare Krishna or something. No, he wanted to create a whole revolution in the world. You know? So unless we understand these things and actually implement them, we will not really get there. Lord Chaitanya Sankirtan movement will not be powerful, you know. And I mean, I think I mentioned this once before, but just for your information, these topics are really meant for everybody to hear. You know, and I know, I have met one Brahmachari disciple of Radhanaswami, and he personally told me how Maharaj instructs the Brahmacharis to preach about Garbhadha and Samskara. You know, so we should not think, oh, for Brahmacharis, Bhaktis, they should not hear these things. Oh God, if I read the word semen, I may become attached to sex life or something. No, come on, it's all in the Bhagavatam, you know. So then, there's a letter to Shamadasi, 18th of January, 69. You have asked me some questions about the function of sex life in Krishna consciousness. And the basic principle is that it should be avoided as far as possible. However, if it is unavoidable, then it should be utilized only for begetting Krishna conscious children. In that case, the husband and wife should chant at least 50 rounds before going to sex. The recommended period is 6 days after the menstruation period. I mean, Prabhupada is very, very practical and outspoken in these things. That instruction, you know, the days after menstruational period, that you also find in one purport of the Bhagavatam. I can't quite remember which one, but it is even in the Bhagavatam, you know? Yes. All these very practical instructions. Because how else would we know if it wasn't in the Bhagavatam, you know? And how else would the future generation of people know, you know, if it's not in the Bhagavatam, you know? We will get to this a little bit later again with the 50 rounds, because it gives us already an indication how expert Prabhupada was in extricating the principles of Garbhadha and Samskara and adjusting it to the modern days of Lord Chaitanya Sankirtan movement. I mean, this instruction of chanting 50 rounds before conceiving a child, you will not find this in the Shastra as part of the Garbhadha and Samskara. No, this is Prabhupada's expertise. You know, how how he teaches us how to extricate the principles and apply them in our time, place and circumstance. But we will see one can actually do so much more even than 50 rounds, you know. So now, fifth canto, fifth chapter, verse 20, we have another nice explanation. Very nice. Prabhupada explains it so perfectly. The heart is situated within the chest, and although instrumentally the son is born with the aid of the genitals, he is actually born from within the heart. According to the heart's situation, the semen takes the form of a body. Therefore, according to the Vedic system, when one begets a child, his heart should be purified through the ritualistic ceremony known as Garbhadan. Rishabhdev's heart was always uncontaminated and spiritually. Consequently, all the sons born from the heart of Rishabhdev were spiritually inclined. You know, very, very nice. Prabhupada describes it. That actually the child is born from within the heart. You know? And according to the heart situation, the semen takes form of a body. You know, because as I'm always explaining, consciousness floods the whole body. So of course also the consciousness also manifests in the semen. It's there in every cell of the body. You know? So therefore the consciousness is also present there. And that way it will affect what soul will be attracted and what consciousness the soul will have. Yeah. So then another nice quote from 3rd Canto, 20th chapter, verse 28. Brahma's mind was not in correct order when he created the demons. There you go. It must have been full of passion, because the entire creation was passionate. Therefore, such passionate sons were born. It follows that any father and mother should also be careful while begetting children. The mental condition of a child depends on the mental status of his parents at the time he is conceived. According to the Vedic system, therefore, the Garbhadan Samskara, or the ceremony for giving birth to a child, is observed. Before begetting a child, one has to sanctify his perplexed mind. I really love this one. You know? One has to sanctify one's perplexed mind. How do you translate perplexed? Perplexed, how do you translate perplexed? Verwirrt. Okay. Yes. Can. Naja, erstaunt could also be positive, but perplexed is puzzled, you know. Yeah, so this is in a nutshell a very nice description what Garbhadan Samskara is all about. One has to sanctify one's perplexed mind. When the parents engage their minds in the lotus feet of the Lord, and in such a state the child is born, naturally good devotee children come. When the society is full of such good population, there is no trouble from demoniac mentalities. So this is Prabhupada's aim, you know, that really the demonic mentalities in human society should be reduced by, you know, the devotees, first of all, bringing about empowered and saintly offspring themselves, but then also teaching it to other people. You know, only then the golden age can come about, obviously, you know. So we have to learn this. We have to be able to preach it. There should be general knowledge in ISKCON for everyone, no matter what ashram people may be, so we can teach and preach about these things. You know? Then another quote, 3:14-38. The conditions for having good progeny in society are that the husband should be disciplined in religious and regulative principles, and the wife should be faithful to the husband. In Bhagavad Gita 7:11, it is said, that sexual intercourse, according to religious principles, is a representation of Krishna consciousness. In fact, Krishna says, this is he himself. You know? Sex life according to regulative principles. Before engaging in sexual intercourse, both the husband and wife must consider their mental condition, the particular time, the husband's direction, and obedience to the demigods. According to Vedic society, there is a suitable, auspicious time for sex life, which is called the time of Garbhadan. Diti neglected all the principles of spiritual injunction, and therefore, although she was very anxious for auspicious children, she was informed that her children would not be worthy to be the sons of a brahmana. So again, you know, Prabhupada stresses this point, how important this is to really consider one's mental condition, you know. Now one more, 3:16-35. The living entity takes shelter within the semen of a father, which is injected within the womb of a mother. And with the help of the mother's emulsified ovum, the living entity grows a particular type of a body. In this connection, it is to be remembered that the mind of Kasyapa Muni was not in order when he conceived the two sons, Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu. Therefore, the semen he discharged was simultaneously extremely powerful and mixed with the quality of anger. It is to be concluded that while conceiving a child, one's mind must be very sober and devotional. For this purpose, the Garbhadan Samskara is recommended in the Vedic scriptures. If the mind of the father is not sober, the semen discharged will not be very good. Thus, the living entity wrapped in the matter produced from the father and mother will be demoniac, like Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyaksha. The conditions of conception are to be carefully studied. This is a very great science. So nice, you know, how Prabhupada presents it all. And in such words he presents it that it is really understandable for all of us. Because, I mean, I also have to share that there is a nice book called Art of Parenting. This is a compilation of all different essays and articles of all kinds of wonderful personalities from ISKCON. Also from Maharaj, as Lokanath Maharaj wrote something, and from different brahmacharis and grihasthas and so on. So I was using also this book as material, you know, for putting this course together. So, yeah, if you can get a hand on this book, it is helpful to read it. There is also another book on the Garbhadan Samskara specifically. It's got a blue cover. I did look at this, but for me it was just too technical, too complicated. And yeah, I don't know. Because, I mean, it's very clear also, if we make this whole topic of Garbhadan Samskara too complicated, too technical, with too many ritualistic things and mantras and this and that, I doubt it how many people will be able to follow this, you know? So, and I mean, naturally, I do talk to devotees, and sometimes Grihastha couples, they also share with me. Yes, the first two kids we had, they were not planned. Let's be honest, wife was just pregnant. Okay. So, but then they thought, okay, let's give it another shot and let's do it properly, And then the third one is conceived with Garbhadhana Samskara and proper planning and purifying the perplexed mind and all this, So sometimes it takes families a few attempts until they manage to at least do it once properly, But of course, others, especially when they get that education before, and especially if they have not engaged so much in sex life before they come to Krishna consciousness, then they start, their whole Grihastha life with a cleaner sheet, so to speak, and then there's not so many bad habits and impressions and so on, and then we have a better start, very clear. So depending on our individual situation, we may be able to already do it with the first child, properly, and we try our best and so on and so on, But then others need a bit more, a few more attempts to get there, So actually, the Garbhadhana Samskara in itself involves mainly two mantras, which should be chanted just before conception. And we have here on the sheet the translation. To be honest, I didn't research too much, but I couldn't even find the Sanskrit of these two mantras. It's not in the Art of Parenting book. And, I mean, we will get back in a minute to Prabhupada's formula of chanting 50 rounds, So I started realizing maybe no such big importance to even know the Sanskrit and all this, But we'll get to that in a minute. So, but nevertheless, it's interesting to know what it is all about. So the translation of these two mantras is the following. The Supreme Father of the universe empowers your womb contemplating ideal progeny. May the Supreme Carpenter, der höchste Schreiner, may the Supreme Carpenter fashion the celestial form sentient. It is an appeal, May the Supreme Carpenter fashion, create the celestial form sentient. May the Supreme Father carry out the fertilization, and may the Lord, as the Supreme Maintainer, present a fetus to you, representative of the Lord. That's the translation of one mantra. And the other one is, O Supreme Mother, fair-armed, presiding over birth, please bestow a child in the womb. O Supreme Mother, voice of the Lord's Vedas, please sanction a child in the womb. O dual celestial physicians, bedecked with lotus garlands, please grant a child with perfect spiritual health. Well, there's the source, you have it, Chandogya Brahmana 1467 Rig Veda Samhita and verse number. So if you really want to know the Sanskrit, you can try and find it somewhere. But in Prabhupada's books, it is not there, Yes. So, yes, we can say in a very genius way, Prabhupada extracts the principle. He says, chant 50 rounds, on the day of conception. So, huh? Yes. Well, 64 is an auspicious number, definitely in itself, but what I have heard is 50. Of course, no harm to 1064. Even better, you know. But yeah, in that letter we read before, he was saying 50 or so, you know. So because, as we know, chanting the Maha Mantra is the most powerful way of purifying the complexed, perplexed mind, you know, and bringing about a devotional attitude, sober and devotional, Prabhupada says in the previous purport, you know. So, and of course, sometimes we come across this that people say, oh, chanting 50 hours, I don't have the time for this. You know, this is quite a common argument. I don't have the time for this, sorry. But then the other argument against this is, well, to bring up a child would take so much more of your energy. You know, so if you can't even chant 50 rounds, then how will you bring up a child in Krishna consciousness? Then you have to sacrifice so much more quality time and attention and so on, you know. So, well, this is how we show Krishna, you know, our sincerity by somehow making the arrangement that we find the time to chant 50 rounds, you know. Yes. And this basically takes almost the whole day, actually, depending on how early you get up and how fast you chant. But it takes quite some time. And I mean, I can share from my own experience, because when I was married, we were practicing this. We were chanting 50 rounds for quite some time every month, you know. And it does have a powerful effect. I can only recommend it, because it really changes your whole attitude and understanding to sex life. You start realizing this is what sex life is actually meant to be all about, for having children. You know? Yes. 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 So it's very helpful to actually do this, you know. And of course, after chanting 50 rounds, you don't really feel so inclined for sex life anyway. So and the whole spontaneity is gone, you know, because what makes sex life exciting is the spontaneous thing there and so on. But if it's all planned and programmed and you prepare yourself for the whole day, so that is already gone, you know. So, yeah, I mean, it's a power. I mean, Prabhupada knows, you know, Prabhupada knows what is really purifying for us, you know, if we actually accept this part of really chanting 50 rounds. But then also, one can even do so much more than that. So much more. Because chanting 50 rounds, that's just the preparation on the day. But actually, one can already start, you know, 1, 2, 6, 12 months before and start preparing to purify one's perplexed mind. You know, this is not so easily done just within one day, you know, to create a really sober and devotional attitude. So, for example, Ayurvedic texts, they also recommend diet and lifestyle changes a year before, which are conducive to the Garbhadhan Samskara, you know. So, especially for the lady, she can already get rid of a few toxins, because actually during pregnancy, the toxins in the body of the mother do go in the fetus of the child. So it's highly recommended to go on a diet, maybe no sugar. I highly recommend it. You can accept my diet. That will be a perfect diet to prepare. No sugar, no fried things, some raw things, juices, you know, these things. This is a perfect diet, you know. Just to detoxify a little bit, you know, especially white sugar. You know, if one can cut that out, you know, for the last 6 months before or something, this will be very beneficial, yeah. And I'm sure for the husband also, you know. Yes. And lifestyle changes. So that means, you know, really shaping up, basically, you know, to really be serious, to be very regulated, to get up early and have good sadhana, you know. So the whole idea is that we want to increase the mood, you know. The mood is to increase our devotional service. Definitely not decrease, but increase. It should be the mood of preparing to invite a special soul, you know. And we can even make this very personal, that we pray for a certain personality with certain attractions and inclinations to take birth in our family. Like I know one family in Mayapur, they were praying to have a son who would assist Pankajangri and Janani Vasprabhu in Mayapur to worship Lord Nrisimhadev. You know? So one can make this very personal, that one can pray for a certain personality with a certain mood and attraction within Krishna consciousness to take birth. Or one can pray for a soul that distributes tons of books, you know. Or one can pray for a soul who will really spread the pure chanting of the holy name or something, you know. And that adds a certain personal aspect and a certain sweetness there in this whole process of preparing and inviting a special soul, you know. It can be a whole meditation, right? And obviously Krishna is there in the heart as Paramatma. He sees exactly our desires. So why should he not fulfill them, you know, if we are serious enough? You know, that he says, all right, you know, this family is ready. They want to invite a very special soul. So, all right, let them have that special soul in their family, you know. Because also, as we know, the demigods, they are queuing up to take birth in Lord Chaitanya Sankirtan movement. They're standing in line there. But they don't want to just take birth in any family. They want to have a Paka family, you know. Yes, where there is really the culture of sadhana there, and the culture of devotional life in the home. That's where they want to take birth, you know. So they're queuing up there, but we are not inviting them. You know, that's the problem. They're waiting, but we are not. Yeah, we are not inviting them, you know. Yes. Yeah, so the principles of Garbhadhan Samskara, once again, we've got a little list here of different points. Inducing a spiritual atmosphere within and around ourselves. This is the whole idea, you know, that internally and also around ourselves, we want to really create a spiritual atmosphere so that really the soul that takes birth has right from very beginning the very best chances to actually make this life the last life and really make a contribution to Lord Chaitanya Sankirtan movement, you know. Purification of the body and consciousness by accepting tapasya and increasing shravanam kirtanam. So this is, you know, another principle of this whole Garbhadhan Samskara. So it can be so much more than just chanting 50 rounds on that day, you know, that we actually purify the body, as we mentioned, by accepting diet, a certain diet, and accepting a bit more tapasya in our life and increasing shravanam kirtanam, you know, for a certain period of time before conception. So this can mean practically that we increase physical, emotional, mental and spiritual health before conception. We harmonize the mind. Yeah, so ideally, you know, everything should be very harmonious in our life. And emotional, mental, spiritual strength and health should be there. And everything should be nicely arranged. You know, we will get to this a little later or so. But that's the whole idea. And practically, this can be done, for example, by reading a little bit extra every day, you know, that let's say a family says, okay, in 6 months' time, we want to try to conceive a child. So then for the 6 months, it's a very personal matter. We can make our personal program. What are our sources of inspiration? That, for example, we can just say, yes, for 6 months, I read one chapter of Bhagavad Gita every day, or one chapter of the Bhagavatam every day, you know. Or we have some favorite verses, favorite prayers we want to chant every day, Nrisinga Kavacha or Brahma Samhita or whatever inspires us, you know. Or we can say, okay, let me chant every day some extra rounds for 1 month, 3 months, 6 months. That's an individual thing, depending on how seriously we really want to prepare and really purify the perplexed mind, you know, and create a sober and devotional consciousness. So there is flexibility there, you know. Yes. And as I said, we can pray for a person with certain qualities, mood, to appear, and chanting 50 rounds on the day of conception, you know. That, if we want to really implement this Garbhadhan Samskara, we can say chanting 50 rounds is the minimum on the day. But then there can be so much more, actually, you know, and depending on how seriously we want to apply this, we can do this 1 month or 3 months or 6 months or 12 months or whatever, you know, like that. Yes. Yeah, also once I heard this nice statement, which just makes very practically, it makes sense, you know, that the Krishna conscious father and the mother can be compared to the fertile soil and the good seed when we plant something out there, you know. So both is required. Just only having the fertile soil is not enough if the seeds are no good. And just having the good seeds, but the soil is not prepared and fertile, also useless. So we need both. Just like in agriculture, we need both. We need the fertile soil and the good seed. You know? So makes sense. Right. Yes. Also, let me just mention a few little practical details, you know, for conception. Very important that the environment, everything is clean and pure, uplifting, you know, spiritual atmosphere in the home. Wife should cook a nice feast, because especially the husband, you know, should eat pretty, rich foods, actually, that will make the semen more powerful. It is said the wife should fast, the husband should feast. And we should ask for the blessings of seniors, of guru, and so on. And definitely, the more we can be celibate before, the better. You know? Like that. And also, it is said, if the wife is more lusty, then there's more of a chance that it will be a girl. And if the husband is more lusty, then there's more of a chance that it will be a boy. Like that. So let me just see if we have some questions. Do we have any questions? Okay.
I read one article by Urmila Mataji about education, and she writes that this Gabadan Sanskar, it makes about 20% of influence on the consciousness of the child. Can you say something?
And the rest comes through education or what?
I just remember that.
To comment on it, I would have to read the article. I don't know, I have never heard this. I have not read it in Prabhupada's books and also not in the article.
Yeah, I also saw in this article. In Back to Godhead, there was a series of education.
Don't know. I mean, Urmila Mataji is very qualified. She has a lot of knowledge and so on, but I would not be able to comment on this without reading her article. Yes. Do we have anything else? Yes, Prabhu.
Sorry, just a practical comment. I think the one thing when we hear all of this, we think, oh, it's something scary, something very technical. And what you said all is fine. We should make it like a little bit like a festival. Not that we enjoy it, but that is something what is enjoyable, not the act, but to really come to consciousness, we creating, we want to have a nice Krishna conscious child, and we should envision the child, as I said, we can pray for a child, and we should envision, because it starts first, take birth in the heart, right? And then it comes in the mind, and then from there goes to the semen, and from there to the womb. Yes. So it can be, it should be actually a very joyous festival, we making a child for Krishna. Yes. And then it becomes not that technical, and even the things what we do in addition and chanting 15 rounds is kind of an exciting preparation.
Exactly.
And the key point, I think, is really because Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, the time when you leave the body is very important, the consciousness. Yes. Same time when you come to the body, the consciousness. So everything what helps to, in this moment, that the mind and the senses are not carried away by material emotions, that they are stimulated by spiritual emotions. Mm. And this is, I found that it's very helpful to not become too technical,
I mean, if we think this is technical, then have a look at this blue Gabadan Samskar book, and then you realize what is technical. Because that, my God, I could hardly even understand anything.
Prayers, these prayers, they are actually very, very deep and very, very agitating the spiritual emotions.
What? What's the difference between spiritual emotions and material emotions? I mean, what was the definition of each one?
Prabhupada, what?
No, Prabhupada was saying spiritual emotions and material emotions, but...
Well, material emotions are not connected with Krishna, and spiritual emotions are connected with Krishna. That's always the difference between material and spiritual.
You mean material emotions like envy, pride, and so on? These are considered
any emotions... not connected with Krishna. You know? So Yes.
Okay. Just, I mean, material emotions. I would consider that you focus on. Let's put it like this: the form of your partner, and the pleasure of your senses. Spiritual emotions are when you try to remember in this time the Lord. You know what we do in Puja, there are special meditations to kind of purify the mind. And if one can do that, and the whole Kapodan Samskara, the whole ceremonies, everything is pointed to this particular point.
Yes. And I mean, ultimately, you know, the essence is really that one desires to have a wonderful child and bring that up in Krishna consciousness. Like, I know, for example, devotees where their parents told them that, yes, you were a desired child. We were actually praying for some time, you know. But then other children just, you know, come about, you know. So, and already in these families, you can often see that this child, which was actually really desired, where the mother was really desiring, oh, please, please, God, send me a nice child. You know, even though she doesn't know anything about Garbhodhan Samskara, and she didn't chant 50 rounds. But, you know, Krishna is so kind that even if a mother does not know anything about all of these things, but if she just longs to have a nice child, and she has some piety and inclinations herself for religious life, so then Krishna will fulfill her desire and send a soul that later on becomes a devotee. You know? So even on that level, there's a difference. Even in the Kami world, there's a difference between a child that is born and was a planned and desired child, or child who is just an accidental pregnancy, or whatever we want to call it, you know, or coincidental pregnancy or something. You know, there's a difference, even in the Kami world, you know. So Krishna responds according to our desire, you know. So the more we actually really intentionally and prayerfully want to invite a soul into our family, you know, that already is a good start, rather than thinking, oh, hopefully I will not be pregnant. You know? So already that makes a difference. And then the more we can really tune in and prepare and meditate and desire, you know, that we really look forward to actually having that amazing service and task of bringing a child up in Krishna consciousness, and we really dedicate ourselves, we are ready for this adventure, you know, then Krishna will send somebody who, you know, continues on a higher level, you know. Yes. Because, I mean, we always say the children who are born in Krishna consciousness and families in Krishna consciousness, they continue from previous life. But even there are differences, you know, from previous life. What does that mean? You know, it can be a more elevated soul who almost made it back to Godhead, but then had still something to finish off here. Or it can be a soul, you know, who was not so seriously practicing and just heard something little bit or something, you know, so that there's so many different gradations there, you know, right? So, and yeah, we basically get what we deserve type thing, we can say, you know. Do we have any other question? Yes.
Ich sage das in Deutsch, vielleicht kannst du das übersetzen. In den Büchern von Anastasia heißt es, dass es auch eine große Rolle spielt, wie das Kind zur Welt kommt. Also, dass der Vater eigentlich derjenige ist, der in dem Moment dabei ist und auch das macht im Endeffekt. Und dass die Hebammen mit dabei sein sollen, aber nicht im gleichen Raum, sondern die kommen im Endeffekt nur im Notfall, falls irgendetwas nicht klappt. Kannst du vielleicht dazu was sagen? Und vielleicht die Frage nochmal übersetzen, auch für die Online-Zuhörer.
So, you're referring to some book by Anastasia? No idea who that is. But anyway, in that book it is said that actually the father should be there when the child takes birth, and that it has an influence on the child in which way birth takes place. Well, if you don't mind, first of all, I haven't really researched this so much, and also whether the father should be present or should not be present, there's also different visions on it. And I dare say, from what I know, it is not really meant to be like that, that the father is there. It is actually, traditionally, it's more a women's thing, actually. Yes, because a husband, you know, he is pretty perturbed in the whole thing, because giving birth is a pretty intense thing. I watched it once in my training period of physiotherapy. Whew, you know, it is quite an intense and almost a bit of a traumatic experience there, and it must be hellish pains. And a husband, you know, he feels completely lost there, and he doesn't even know at all how to deal with this whole situation, and I'm not sure, you know. But anyway, yeah, I wouldn't really want to go too much into this topic, first of all, because I haven't personally researched it, and I wouldn't also want to include sources of information which are not based on Krishna consciousness and Shastra, you know, because out there there's so many opinions and ideas and new agey cool theories and so on, and I don't really want to get into all that. Yes, Prabhu?
Upanilamrita is described that at the before the time of delivering the child, Srila Prabhupada's mother, she went to the house of her mother, and there Prabhupada took birth.
Usually it's like that the mothers, grandmothers, they have the experience, and they are there, and they are helping, and because they know what is soothing and helpful and what is simply, you know, agitating in that situation. So this is a science which is passed down through the lines of the mothers, really, you know, because they know. And in former times, women had so many more children than now, you know, they had 6, 7, 8 children, 10 children. So, I mean, they had plenty of experience, you know, so they knew exactly how it's all meant to function, you know. So the men, what will they contribute, you know? Sorry. In that part, at least. Okay, so let us continue just by touching very briefly. As I mentioned, I'm not an expert on samskaras, but still I feel it's good to include it, you know, and have some idea what else is there, you know. So let us understand, you know, bringing up children starts with Garbhadhan Samskara, how we invite a special soul, and then it continues during pregnancy already, you know, already then it continues. So, and there are 10 samskaras. Prabhupada hinted several times also yesterday in some quotes we read that there's 10 samskaras. So first one is Garbhadhan Samskara. So then there's other ones, the Pumsavana Samskara. That is executed to beget a strong son to carry out specific duties. And this is performed before the child begins to move. Maybe Toshini Madhuji, is she here? Maybe she knows she's a doctor and she's pregnant. Maybe she knows exactly which month that is. I haven't mentioned it here. And at this time also, the gender is considered to be established thereafter. Do you know when the child moves? Yes, Prue.
Yeah, it is
in
this time. It should be also after
the third month, and it is 3 months. It should be, secret that the wife is pregnant. Because in this time, the child can be still, because of envy of other women, it can be... Can be miscarriage. So it should be very kept silent, and then there's the first samskara, what you do after 3 months, and as you said, it's good for the child, it's strong, it's good for the mother to be mentally stable, also the next one, and it's also called making a male child, it's for the first pregnancy, because there you can define the gender on this point.
Okay. So ladies, you better absorb this knowledge. Yes. Let me just quickly go. You better stay here because you may have something else to add here to the samskara.
Sorry. You said it's right that we have to understand the first one is Gobadan samskara, but actually the first one is Vivaha samskara.
That comes in my list here at the ninth one. But you're right. But I mean, if we look at the child's development, it doesn't start with Vivaha, you know, so I have that order.
Well, in one sense it does.
From the parents, but not from that personality. So I'm looking at the personality. Yeah, in any case. Yeah, So that samskara is performed around the third month. And just about your comment, I do want to clarify that there are also other reasons for miscarriages. It is not only envy of other women or something. So not that in any case, just in case somebody has a miscarriage, who was envious of my child or something, you know. So, yeah, I mean, that is a general danger in the first 3 months, even just from a medical point of view, that a woman can have miscarriages in the first 3 months. So especially also stress and too restless life, lifting things, all these things can also lead to miscarriages, you know. So it is not only the envy of somebody else or something, you know. So then the next one is Shimantanayana samskara. According to what I have read, this is performed in the fourth month or latest 6 to 8 months. So obviously there's a bit of a time span there. And this is for protection from subtle entities bringing about miscarriages. I got that at that samskara. Anyway, whatever it may be. Formation of mind begins and heart forms at that stage. Do you have anything to add to this Shimantanayana samskara?
No, but just maybe that's a very funny samskara because it's also called parting the wife's hair.
Yes.
That is only done, also the first one, Pumsavan, is only done for the first pregnancy.
Exactly.
But parting the wife's hair gives her is more for her also to make her stable, protector from subtle entities, and it's done with a porcupine.
I've seen it once in Mayapur. I was invited to such a samskara.
I have some porcupines there for this. But we actually in our Gaudiya Vaishnavas we also using peacock feathers.
Yes, good. So then the next one is Shoshayanti samskara. So Sayanti samskara, that's performed in the last month for safe delivery. Is it? Here it says in the 10th month or last month.
One. I mean, this and this is done for every pregnancy, because from this point, therefore they say from the 7 month, because from there, the baby is completely conscious. It hears everything, it understands everything, and this is the point where it starts to pray. What we hear in the Srimad Bhagavatam, where it prays for the Lord that never ever I want to do this again, and I don't want to forget you and all of this. And from this point on, there is very serious that the parents, they, especially the mother, they should listen Bhagavatam.
Yes,
now give this MP3.
Yeah, we get to that.
Yeah, I mean this, but therefore 7 months.
Yes. Okay, well, but I mean, from a medical point of view, to take birth in the, with the, on the seventh month is a little early, you know. So, yeah, I used to work with these Frühchen there, you know. It's
get stimulated, that they're forming around the baby to bring her in a in the birth position. And we had this for our first boy. We had this that we went to the doctor and the baby said everything is fine, the baby just has now to turn. And then we did the samskara and then we sat down afterwards and my wife said, ooh, something is happening, you know, it's like and then we went again and they look and now the baby is in right position. So it's not just hocus pocus. It's true.
Okay, so then after birth, we continue with the samskaras. There's the Namakarana samskara, the name-giving ceremony. So, and then comes the first grain giving, you know? And then the hair cutting.
No, it's not there. Birth ceremony?
No. That's not there. I mean, then it would be also 11.
Yes, you have.
So first grain giving, that is a samskara. Then the hair cutting ceremony is a samskara. Then first school day is a samskara, right? Then the marriage, and then death. So that's 10. I mean, you know, I don't feel that this is now a really big thing here to discuss in more detail, because I am saying again and again, I'm also not so expert in these things. And I would say if somebody is really more interested in these wholesome scars, then maybe Ramananda Prabhu, maybe you want to give, you know, a special seminar just to explain all these samskaras more deeply, because you're the expert, you're performing them, you know. So, but I kind of fear it could be a separate topic, you know, and I only want to touch on it in a general form, just for the completion's sake, that people get this education and understand, yes, these samskaras are not just social functions and where we all get together and chant and have prasadam afterwards, but they are an important part of parenting, you know, like that. Yes. So then let us have a look what else we have. Yes, here during pregnancy, a few more little points. How child raising continues during pregnancy. That yes, the child hears and develops consciousness after the seventh month. And in this regard, I want to share this one story which really blew my mind. When I was in this devotee care committee there from the strategic planning from the GBC, there was one day a couple coming from South India. They were visiting our meeting in Mayapur and they were giving a little presentation. And she was sharing how during her whole pregnancy, every day she read loudly the first 5 chapters of Bhagavad Gita, the Sanskrit, every day, even right from the beginning, not only starting from 7th month, but every day. And at that time, when they made this presentation, their 5-year-old son was there also. And she was saying, now without any further training, whenever they now chant these 5 chapters and stop anywhere, he knows the next verse. Just by hearing in the womb. I mean, I was blown away when I heard this, you know. Yeah, so of course, we all know Prahlad Maharaj heard in the womb and it's in the Bhagavatam. But I have to admit, I did not take it that seriously. I thought, yes, of course, Prahlad Maharaj would hear in the womb. Why wouldn't he, you know? So, but that this is still going on today, now. I mean, I was completely blown away, you know, and I was really thinking, my God, this is what we have to teach our mothers, you know, instead of teaching them all kinds of other stuff at the universities or what, you know, this is the things they have to know, you know, that the child hears in the womb. And just by actually reading loudly to the child or chanting the same verses every day, the child learns them in the womb already. Oh, my God. I mean, I was completely impressed with this, you know. Yes, especially when you see a living example, you know, when you meet somebody like that, where they can verify this, what is written in the Bhagavatam, you know, then it has so much more impact on our minds, you know. And of course, the child feels every emotion of the mother, and the child accepts her consciousness. You know, that's the power of consciousness. It floods the whole body. It keeps every cell in the body alive, and of course, it enters also the child's cells because they're all connected to the mother's body, you know. So that's why I was saying yesterday, this mother-child connection, it is almost a sacred connection. So close, you know. We cannot think that this is the same with the connection of the father, you know. Of course, the father plays an important role and, but, you know, both genders have their roles to play. And they're not the same. They're not equal and exchangeable. You know? No. So the child is also affected by the eating of the mother, of course. You know? But let's be clear. Yes, every emotion the child feels from the mother. So that means, you know, the mother during pregnancy has to be very peaceful, in harmony with herself and the world. There should be no stressful situations, no anxieties. The child feels it all, everything, you know? Yes. You know, there should be no arguments and tensions in the home and all these things. The child hears it all and feels it all, you know? Yes. So, I mean, this is so important to know, so important, you know. And, of course, the child is affected by her eating, what she eats, you know. So, I mean, that even our modern doctors and so on know that during pregnancy one should not eat spicy foods and so on, you know, because the child, you know, cannot digest this. And usually, again, according to Krishna's perfect arrangement, usually women, they don't like to smell spices when they're pregnant. They can't stand it. So this, again, is simply arranged so the child is protected from this. that the mother has an aversion against certain smells and spicy things and so on, you know. So just to protect the child, you know. And, of course, also the non-devotee doctors, you know, they advise don't smoke during the pregnancy, don't drink alcohol during the pregnancy, because this child gets drunk there in the womb, you know, or gets the doses of nicotine there already, you know, and so on, you know. Yes. Yes, so the mother has to be conscious of her thinking, feeling, eating and acting to favor the child's development. You know? Yeah, it's a whole thing. It's a whole thing, you know. So actually during pregnancies, you know, the mother should take it easy, she should read, she should chant, she should have kirtan and be in a not stressful situation. And of course she can do little services and this and that, depending on the, you know, the personality. Some people get quicker in anxiety and some people can in a relaxed mood still do a few tasks and services and also some little responsibilities. So that's an individual thing. But the principle is that the mother should not be in any kind of stressful situations where she's in anxiety, because the child feels it all. You know? So in the father's role is that he gives protective support to the pregnant mother. You know, that he makes sure that she is physically comfortable, emotionally stable, and intensely Krishna conscious. So that's how the father contributes. That's his role, you know. There is also some other letters where I've read that Prabhupada says, especially during pregnancy, the father, the husband has to really make sure that he's really giving care and giving the emotional support, because also often when people are pregnant, you know, the hormones are all different, and you know, we women get more emotional than we usually are, and so on. So a man has to know these things, you know. He has to also be educated how to give the support, you know, because often for men in general it's hard as it is to relate to the emotional nature of a woman. So especially then during pregnancy, he has to be very gentle and caring and affectionate and not take things personal that she may say in some emotional mood or something, but that he understands pregnancy is a special situation, and the child hears everything and feels everything, and he has to give the necessary support, you know. And then later also, the consciousness of the mother is transferred to her milk she gives to the child. Yes. Again, consciousness floods the whole body. It's there in every cell of the body. Of course it is also in the milk. You know? Of course. Of course. The body produces it. You know? So, of course, the non-devotees, all they know is that the child gets the same immune system of the mother through the milk. You know? That is a well-known thing, that if a mother breastfeeds, the child has the same immune system like the mother. That's why it's in many ways less dangerous for a family to go, for example, to India, to Mayapur, while the child is still getting mother's milk. But once the child is not getting mother's milk anymore and is a bit older and puts everything in the mouth and so on, it can be more risky for some infections and diseases. But while the child gets mother's milk, the child has the same immune system, you know. But not only the same immune system, but also gets the consciousness of a mother, you know, through the milk. This is factual, you know. And I once remember I was staying with one family where the mother was breastfeeding. And the mother was not in good shape and very agitated and screaming and at everybody and this and that. And while I was there, I didn't even say anything. But the mother got, while I was there, she got that realization, and she was saying to me one day, she was saying, actually, I noticed when I breastfeed my child in the evening, the child wakes up in my mood and screams for no reason, you know. And she realized, okay, my child gets my consciousness through the milk, and I better watch out, you know. So it's a whole thing, you know. And also we can understand mother's milk is such an important element. I mean, even this is being discouraged these days so much, because it is, I mean, as I'm saying, I'm not so practically experienced in these things because I never experienced this life. But from what I've heard and gathered from what people tell me, it is sometimes a bit of a thing to get the milk flow happening in the mother. It's a bit of an endeavor. And these days in the hospitals, they always say, ah, don't worry about the milk. Here, just have the bottle, you know. Yeah, they just couldn't be bothered, this whole trouble, you know, of breastfeeding. And often the women are also too worried about their body because the body gets a bit out of shape through breastfeeding and this and that. And they rather want to keep their attractive body and no need for breastfeeding, too much trouble. I'm going to work anyway and I'm not there to breastfeed and all this. But no, you know, this is all part of Krishna's arrangement here, you know. And there's nothing better for a child than getting the mother's milk, you know. And her milk can be seen as the love of her heart for the child. And that love is transformed, you know. No, the love transforms her blood into milk. Prabhupada says the same with the cows too, you know. That is actually the milk of the cow is the love of the cow. And if we treat the cows nicely, then their milk is so much higher quality milk, and it is more milk, you know. And that's why in India you still see how the farmers, they're tying the calf in front of the mother, because the cow's love for the calf makes the milk flow, you know. So Prabhupada explains the same things in regards to cows too. So same thing can be transferred also to the mother, you know. And the child can drink the milk up to 4 or 5 years of age, you know. Yes. So we shouldn't think this is weird or something. You know, the more the child gets the mother's milk, the better. The better. Yes. Yeah. And I mean, just since we're talking about breastfeeding, just briefly, I was once conducting this big Pandal program there in Mayapur, and the topic was the glories of our mothers. And I had one Mataji who has lived many years in Mayapur, and she raised 2 children, Prabhupada Priya Mataji, maybe somebody knows her, she's very, very nice devotee. So she was sharing this nice thing that because often it is difficult for the mothers to find time to chant their rounds. And she was sharing how every time when she was breastfeeding her children, she was chanting japa. And so for the children, this created a very powerful and positive impression in their minds, you know, that the child was connecting that warm and sheltered feeling of being fed by the mother with chanting the holy name, you know? And it created very positive impressions in the minds for the child towards chanting japa. And she was describing how once when the child was older, was already running around, 2 or 3 years old or something, and the child wanted to be fed, then she was running, looking, where's mum's bead bag? And then she finally found the bead bag and was running to the mother, here, chant, and let me have some milk while you chant. So it is a, you know, a very nice and powerful way to you know, give the child a positive experience of chanting, you know. Very simple, practical. The mother gets the time to chant around, and the child hears the holy name and absorbs that connection of chanting being a very warm and nourishing and nice and comforting experience. You know, exactly what we want to give to the children, you know. Okay, so time is up. Do we have just maybe one quick question about this topic of, you know, how the child raising continues during pregnancy, basically. Yes, Prabhu.
It's not a question, it's a comment. I heard that actually the ears develop after 3 months of pregnancy. And that's
what is
the ears. The hearing ability develops after 3 months of pregnancy, and that's why, that's when the child actually starts being affected and building impressions from whatever the surroundings are. So if the parents are having some serious discussion or screaming or something, it affects him.
But I dare say the child feels it even before. Maybe not too the sense of hearing, but just through the energy and emotions and the consciousness.
But the thing is, hearing can, you know, the mother, for example, of course, maybe not in Krishna consciousness, but she can be watching a movie and there's all kind of nonsense sounds coming out.
Yes.
And the mother maybe, you know, maybe aloof from all these emotions happening in the movies, in the movie and the sounds, but the child actually is being affected by it.
Yes.
And
That's a good point. Yeah. Nevertheless, emotions are so subtle, you know? So even if the mother is not so affected, but it affects her consciousness in a subtle way. You know, movies are very powerfully affecting the consciousness. One identifies with certain characters and this and that. Very powerful. So it's still, even though, of course, I understand your point, but still, the child will be affected. So all I would like to make clear that we should not think, okay, child only starts hearing at the 3rd month, so first 2 months I can do all kinds of nonsense, you know? Because no, the consciousness, the child will still somehow absorb the consciousness, you know? Yeah, but it's a good point. And just let me mention one thing. I heard that even material scientists came to this conclusion that the child hears in the womb. And they have made different research by playing a certain kind of music, you know, to children. One child hears mainly rock music during pregnancy, one child classical music. And they have noticed when the child takes birth, they react differently to the music which they heard during pregnancy and music which they didn't hear, you know. So even the modern scientists agree with this point now that the child hears in the womb. Yes.
I once heard a lecture from Bhaktivedanta Goswami Maharaj, and he's saying about this first, I don't know what's number of the samskara, that the first 3 months after birth. So, in the Vedic culture, the woman used to actually stay with her child and not expose him to any outside interference, like from people, because this child also feels, if somebody is annoyed or something, the child feels.
Yes.
Or
very
the mother may not notice this.
Yes. Yes. This I have also heard that the first 3 months, the child simply has not established some protective, you know, shield towards subtle energies. And therefore, the child is so much more subjected to all kinds of subtle energies and influences. And that's why the child should not be taken around and so on, you know. Yes. 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 So this is also good to know. You know? Okay, good. Thank you. All right. Thank you very much. And we continue at 6 o'clock tonight. Thank you. Srila Prabhupada ki, Samaveda Bhaktivedanta ki, Gaura Premanandi.